Okay, first off, I'd like to thank everybody at the Fiesta Bowl committee for a great week so far. The hospitality and organization has been terrific, just like we thought it would be. I think our staff, our players, everybody in our program has enjoyed the experience so far while trying to stay focused on the game. I know our players are getting really excited about playing in this venue, in this great bowl game, and we've had good practices. I think it's going to be a great thing for our fans, and we're excited to represent the University of Arizona up here in the Valley.
We'll open it for questions, starting here in the front, right?
Daniel Burke, the Arizona Tucson. Coach, in a bowl game, how much do you rely on your seniors to maybe set the tone early and show the younger guys the right way to play in a game like this?
Yeah, I think it's important for the seniors all season, but in particular here when you're going to spend 4 or 5 days in another environment and making sure they're focused and preparation. You have that balance as a coach. You want them to enjoy the experience and the things that a bowl game presents, but keep your focus on what we call the main thing, which is obviously getting ready to play the game. I think the seniors have done that. They've done a good job all year. It's a neat group. There's some 4-year and some 5th-year seniors. There's a couple of 2-year seniors. There's even 1 or 2 1-year seniors, and they've all kind of come together and done a good job all year of sometimes being loud in their leadership and sometimes being quiet in leadership. They've done a really nice job.
Next question. Here in the back on the right.
Greg Hansen, Daily Star. Through all the bowl games you've been in, can you get a vibe on the psyche of the team going in?
I thought I could, but anymore, I think you get a good feeling if you make a lot of mental mistakes during practice, particularly the last couple of practices, that maybe your guys aren't, either your game plan is too much or your guys aren't as dialed in as you think. But I don't know if that's necessarily the case. Our guys have been pretty sharp mentally this week, which has been good. But there's another bowl games I've been in where we've had a lot of mistakes, you know, a day or two before the game. They come out and played, executed really well. So I think more than anything, you can kind of tell by their excitement level as the practice is geared toward get closer to game time, and our guys seem pretty excited after yesterday's practice. Again, I don't know, I heard Brian say whether it was because their game was closer or their practice was over. Either way, I think you're ready to play.
Here in the front on the left.
I guess Roger Galloway, KMTR Radio. Coach, I'm wondering, you've done a great job, of course, with the University of Arizona. You've also had some interesting experiences with Michigan and West Virginia. How would you compare the support that you've received from the athletic departments of the three schools?
Well, I've been fortunate to be more than that, those three, but those three, I think they're comparative in a lot of ways. I think there's great support, all three of them, you know, West Virginia, Michigan, and certainly the University of Arizona. Athletics is a big part of the university and of the town, and you get great fan support. It's important. Athletics and winning is important, and that's been good. But I think they're all a little bit different too. It's, you know, for any coach to think that you go to one school or another school and you don't have issues or things to overcome. Everybody's got things to overcome. Some got more than others. But all I know is that since day one, when we got to University of Arizona a few years back, everybody has been totally supportive, both in and outside the athletic department, and have been rooting for us to do well since day one. And I think that's helped us in the transition.
In the back left.
Jeff Davis, KPIK Radio. Boise State's had a reputation in these games specifically for some people call them trick plays or misdirection. And certainly during the regular season, they've done that again. So how have you prepared, and how do you prepare a team for the unexpected?
Well, it's harder, obviously, defensively, because they'll do a lot of different things, but I don't know if you can call them trick plays because they execute so well and do it so often. But you've got to be ready not only for the so-called traditional trick plays, but unbalanced formations, unconventional looks that you'll see, and they do a great job of executing. That's the biggest thing. They've got good players that execute well and play really hard. But for a defensive staff, they have to spend a lot of time on formations and possible things that could happen out of it. And then you got to rely on some experience, and we've got a few experienced guys in the secondary especially that they have to recognize when something maybe is a little bit off or something might be coming that they hadn't seen before.
Here in front.
J. Chad Crafton, Idaho Statesman. What's your, are you guys going to go to the stadium at all before game day? And what's kind of your philosophy on whether it's important to get out there?
Yeah, we don't do much on Fridays. It's a lot of coaches have different philosophy. You know, we run around a little bit on Thursday, 2 days before the games. Our Fridays or day before the game, which is today, we'll go over to the stadium, just walk through, let them get a feel for it. Go through a few last-second reminders, and then we'll have a couple meetings today, and that's about it. It's usually just a day to relax, and then we'll meet tonight, show a little film, do some last-minute reminders, and then the day of the game, we'll just get up and eat some breakfast and go play, which is kind of nice for us because we're used to night games. So I don't know about the players, I like waking up and playing.
Brad, in front.
Brad, Sussmat, Sports 360.
Hey, Brad.
Hey, Rich. I'm curious, the national story today is Jim Harbaugh going to Michigan. You have some thoughts not just on that, but also the salary structure. That
I didn't hear that. Really?
Stunning, right?
And what was he getting paid?
The decimal points moved down a little bit.
Okay.
You have some thoughts on that?
Gosh, he just caught me off guard there. I didn't think I'd get a Michigan question. I'm happy for Jim. And I think Michigan has great support without question. They've got tremendous fan support, great resources, and it looks like that's what they targeted Jim from probably day one. And they're probably thrilled that he's coming back. I don't know him, but I know he wins. And he had great success there as a player. He's had great success as a coach, and I'm sure they're excited.
On the left.
Jason Bartella, AZW Swarm. What's this week been like for you with the staff after having missed out on the 2008 game with a lot of these guys?
Yeah, I wasn't here the last time that a lot of my staff was here, and it's been like a normal, I guess, not just a normal bowl week, but a normal work week for us. You know, we kind of kept the same schedule as normal as coaches. Normally we meet and watch film before practice. This week we practice and then the coaches watch film afterwards. But other than that, it's been a normal thing. And I think the bowl folks do a great job of having a few events that are really nice that the coaches and the players are part of, but also giving you a lot of time to get your work done. And so I think it's been a great mix. And our staff is really close. But when we get here, a lot of the families are together, and so I like to give them some family time, particularly in the evening. I think they've enjoyed.
Second row here.
Yeah, hi, Jason Bark, UBC Station in Tucson. What are your thoughts on playing at University of Phoenix Stadium? Have you been inside the stadium before, and the fact that the Super Bowl is going to be there in a few weeks?
No, I haven't. I've been. Coach Aarons is a good friend of mine, and so we've had an invitation, I think. I called BA first, but. To come here and watch, but it's so busy. I'm excited about being in it. It's a great venue, and you know, the fact that they're having a Super Bowl here, and it's a pro stadium, and it'll be first-class amenities all the way. I know our players are pretty jacked up about it, so we're going to go take a look at it here in a couple hours.
Staying here in the second row.
What was the vibe of yesterday's practice, with it being the last one before the game and the last one for the seniors overall?
It was pretty good. It was pretty focused. I thought it would, the beginning of practice, they would be more excited to get it started. But I think as practice went along, it was probably a little nostalgic for the seniors, realizing it was their last one. And we recognized them afterwards and had them get carried off. I always do that, carry the seniors off the last practice on campus before the last home game, and then their last practice period, which was yesterday. And so that was probably, you know, emotional and exciting for the seniors particularly. And I want our underclassmen to maybe see, you know, what it's going to feel like, hopefully, for them when they get an opportunity in their last game, because it goes by so quickly, and the seniors will probably all tell you that this is a pretty neat way to end their careers.
Here in front.
Coach, you've got a lot of guys on your team that started their college football careers someplace else, and whether JC or another four-year school. How did that come to be, and how have you gotten, you know, these guys to all buy into something together and produce these kind of results?
Yeah, we got a bunch of misfits, coaches included. You know, it's a band of misfits, and some of them have been there at U of A the whole career. Some of them have been bounced around a little bit. And, you know, I think we have a kind of environment that that welcomes guys like that, but they have to adjust to us. As I tell everybody, you know, I've been asked that question before. How do you adjust when you get guys coming, whether they're coming from a another four-year school, or they're a walk-on or a scholarship, or they're a bounce back from a junior college or what have you. And I said, they don't, you know, they have to adjust to the program. The program doesn't adjust to them. And I think they sense that as soon as they get there, that this is sometimes a second opportunity or sometimes a chance for them to start over again. And but they have to buy into what the program's about. And our guys have done a really good job of that. You know, you're still going to build your program mostly on high school recruits, and your recruiting is based on that. But to have a few extra guys from different backgrounds or different situations, I've always been able to have a few that's been able to help, and this year's no different.
Here on the right.
Going into this season, how concerned were you offensively without having Kadeem? And then looking back, how pleasantly surprised have you been maybe with how well the offense has done without him?
Yeah, we lost not only Kadeem, but all of our, you know, breaking in a new quarterback, breaking in a new running back, a couple of new linemen. And so there were a lot of question marks coming in. And, you know, we thought there was some talent there, but, you know, still there wasn't anybody that was going to match Kadeem Carey. I thought he was one of the best in the country. And we got Nick Wilson and Terrace Jones. Grigsby both did a nice job. Whether he's as good as Kadeem, no, but Kadeem was special. But they did a good enough job for us to have some success running the football. At times we didn't run as well, hadn't been able to run as well as we'd like, but they're good football players, and I think our talent on outside of the skill positions helped offset that loss of the D.
Here in the front left.
Roger Galloway, KNTR Radio. Coach, asked a similar question a little earlier. I'm wondering if the game is not going well, and it's halftime, and you're going to be giving a little talk to the players. Rumors are that you sometimes get visual with, you know,
really?
Visibly a little
I
upset.
Get ticked.
How do you handle, what's your demeanor like, and your approach to the players, and does it work for you?
Well, usually if we're not playing well, I'm ticked, and if we're playing well, I'm not. It's pretty, you know, I try to hide it. You know, I always tell it, it's the same way practice. I mean, I don't, you know, usually you can tell if, you know, if we're playing well by our demeanor. You know, I'm not going to be one that's, you know, like I said, if a guy's playing really poorly or not giving great effort, I'm not going to pat him on the back and tell him I love him. Let's hold hands, sing kumbaya, and we'll be okay at the end. You know, that's just not the way we operate. But then again, I don't think you can scream and yell your way into playing better. I think you got to look at reasons why. If you're not playing well, why aren't you playing well? Is it something we need to do as coaches? Is it something we need to simplify? Is it maybe the guy's just not focused? Maybe he's banged up a little bit, what have you. I think you look at all the reasons why, but we just go play. And I think one of the reasons we've had some success this year is that our guys believe that. Let's just go play for 60 minutes. And we've won a lot of games at the end. We've lost a couple at the end, but our guys have just played. And we've been down big at halftime in some games this year, but our guys just went and played. And I probably screamed and yelled a little bit, but most of halftime is not as much time as everybody thinks for adjustments. You got about 10 minutes by the time the coaches get in there, out of the box, they meet and then talk with the players. You got about 10 minutes to make a few adjustments, but you better be making them throughout the game. And so I think the halftime talks and the halftime adjustments are usually overrated.
Any other questions? Here in the front, right?
You talked yesterday about this team's ability to play for four quarters, no matter what the scores that you were just saying. Why do you think this team has embraced the 60 minutes of Arizona so well?
Well, we talked about so much. I thought even the first day of practice back in August, I said, this is a team. I think we have some talent, but we're not a team that's just going to get off the bus or show up and dominate someone physically. You know, we got to be guys that play hard, execute well, and just keep playing to the end. And conditioning is going to be a big part of it. I thought our guys were in really good shape at the beginning of camp, and we try to practice to keep that conditioning level up. And so I think our guys truly believe that they're in really good shape and they can play for four quarters and play for 60 minutes. But I think they also know that we got to do it that way. And not that we don't have talent, because we do, but we're not so talented that we can go and mess around and win. You guys have covered us, Daniel. I've said for years, I'll know we truly arrived when we can show up, play poorly, and still win. We're not there, you know. But we have the ability to play well at times, and if we do enough of that and give us a chance at the end, who knows what happens.
The far left here.
Coach, there have been a lot of lopsided games this year, a lot of 35, 40-point win spreads. Does this surprise you? And what do you do when you feel it slipping away or when you feel yourself winning by that much? For you?
Well, yeah, when you're winning, it's all good. You know, let's keep it going. But I think it's more than anything, you got to try to, if you're, momentum is such a big deal in football at all levels, but particularly at this level. If the momentum is clearly on the other team, you got to do something to try to stop, to stem the tide a little bit and get some momentum going and get your guys to believe. And, you know, we've been, like I said, we were down big in a game or two this year, and our guys kept playing. And our last game wasn't good in that regard, but I think a lot of times it's just guys just to keep playing. It's something to shift the momentum. But it's an emotional game. You got to try to turn it somehow. You hope that you guys have the mindset that I don't ever look at the scoreboard, whether we're ahead or behind anyway, until the last second takes off.
Staying here in the back left.
Coach, how did the team respond to the loss in the Pac-12 championship game? And is this game, even 3 or 4 weeks down the road, a shot of redemption for them?
Yeah, I don't know if it's redemption because that game was a different team and a different environment. But, you know, I don't normally say 24 hours move on. I was mad for a couple weeks afterwards. I think the players responded a little easier. They were probably over it after a couple days. But, you know, we talked about it and tried to correct our mistakes from there. But it's so far removed now, and it's a whole different kind of deal with this. So, I think our guys have probably, maybe it's in their back of the mind because it's the last game we play, but I don't want them really thinking about it, and I don't think they'll be thinking about it tomorrow when we tee it up.
Any other questions? Wonderful. Well, that concludes today's press conference. Thank you for your participation.
Thanks, guys.